I would be very glad if they took from this book, is that there is this extraordinary tradition of academic ambition, which is something to be intensely proud of, and which we do still find traces of, albeit often in retreats today. But to go into that tradition, it starts really with Livingstone, and I delve a little into his personal history. It's very narrowly focused on just a bit of Livingstone's story, which I think is relevant to this. So his early experiences, he grows up in appalling poverty. Poverty which would be perfectly comparable on the Hebridean island of Malta with conditions that might have existed in Central Africa and around that time. They then moved to Blantyre and the family put to work in the mill, and he's there working 10-hour days from age 10. But the mill owner has this vision of the possibilities of education, and there is a school which he goes to and he flourishes, and then he starts self-educating himself in addition to doing these long days working at the spinning jenny. And he teaches himself Latin and Greek to a better standard than most graduates from Oxford today. And not just him, his siblings also, independently of his success, use education to substantially better their lives. And it's uncanny that it's a very similar background of poverty that Dr. Robert Laws emerges from, albeit in Aberdeen, not Glasgow. A very poor family, but again, with this powerful conception of how education can transform their lives. And Laws teaches himself Greek. He can't afford the books, he can't afford the Greek grammar that he wants. So he borrows a copy from the book dealer and makes a complete facsimile of this Greek grammar by hand, and that's how he teaches himself Greek. And so both men brought this vision to Malawi, thinking this is what we can achieve here, why not? And in particular at Livingstonia, the results are absolutely astonishing. Despite the fact that this is all being achieved against the backdrop of local warfare, which is only just starting to subside, a very, very active slaving fiefdom under Mosi in the north, and in just the extraordinary difficult material, physical conditions of trying to get stuff, up that road to Livingstonia to build the place. He's also advancing this educational program of an ambition which I find absolutely fantastic. He has to learn the local languages first, and only then can he write a dictionary, and only then can he translate the Bible, and only then can he start teaching people how to read it. But he discovers the appetite for literacy is so enormous that soon after that he says, well, actually, I think we can move on to Latin and Greek, and then Hebrew. And he does.
Yeah.
He actually gets his anger, and it's all within his own lifetime at Livingstonia. So by the time he leaves, when he retired at 57, the standards of the exams that are being examined there. I quote some examples of the questions from my book, which I can remember. So one exam question would be, compare and contrast the moral philosophies of Plato and Aristotle. So one was distinguish Trinity from Triunity. And then my personal favourite was, God does not, by predestination, destroy in me the freedom which is necessary for moral growth. Discuss.
Right.
And this was when, 30 years before, literacy was virtually unheard of in the region. So the achievement is absolutely titanic.
So we got the best collection of rare Malawian and Greek. So customers walk in here, they walk into that shop, which is
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I mean, the memory of a proposal is still wonderful, preserved in the lobby.
No, yeah,
but
nice.
In the UK, even in Scotland,
yeah.
This giant of
yeah.
Victorian mission and
yeah.
Victorian endeavour is completely forgotten. I met not that long ago. I met a UK civil servant about my age, also Oxford educated.
Yeah.
He'd worked for DFID previously.
Yeah.
And when I recounted this story, he shuddered
yeah.
and just muttered uncomfortably yeah. something about cultural imperialism. And I would contend, and yes, I'm afraid the book is controversial, there is a polemical aspect here.
Yeah.
I find this attitude infuriating.
Yeah.
This was not culture that was being foisted upon unwilling subject peoples. It was being embraced with enormous enthusiasm and appetite
sure.
at Livingstonia. And what is absolutely amazing to me is once this educational framework has been established, what you get is not, and very, very quickly what you get is not people who are just parroting.
Yeah.
what they've been told by their colonial masters.
Yeah.
You get men of truly independent minds.
Yeah. Yeah.
You get that first generation of Malawian writers, thinkers,
yeah.
poets, musicians, critics. Exactly. And is that exactly? Because they don't just reach to Malawi, they percolate all through Southern
yeah.
Africa.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
the Kaunda's parents,
yeah.
so it's Kadali.
Yeah.
But then in Malawi you've got these writers who have these extraordinarily profound and original and sophisticated criticisms of Western society. And they're activists as well. They,
yeah.
And like Charles Chambo
yeah, yeah,
are effectively challenging colonial policy,
yeah.
but they're also writing these very, very interesting criticisms, like Levi Lumba's identifying individualism as the poisonous heart
yeah.
of Western
yeah.
society. And the aspect of it which is so destructive
yeah.
to local society.
Right,
and that's
right.
in 1930 when there weren't even that many Westerners
yeah,
here.
Right,
I mean, to make to,
yeah.
it's so incredibly perceptive
yeah, yeah,
for that period.
Yeah. Then open up two professions and then you'll be between one. Besides.
No, absolutely. I mean, these are incredibly legitimate criticisms. I feel they stray, I suppose, into a species of political question that I don't feel particularly inclined to make a judgment on. I suppose I would say, in general, the question is, one, do you believe in the principle of elite education or not? Whether it's in Malawi, UK, America, whatever. And by implication, do you believe that elite education should be funded with inevitably disproportionate funding relative to non-elite education? And second, do you think the classics should be part of that? The whole thing is made much more egregious because it's being done in a very poor country like Malawi, and that's why it's such a difficult one to stomach if you're not sympathetic to the classics or the elite education. As it won't surprise, as I expect you'll hear, I do think elite education is a good thing, and I do think it deserves disproportionate funding. The question of whether or not it deserves that level of disproportionate funding and whether that is justified in a country like Malawi is, however, I would say, a political question for Malawians to answer rather than yes, rather than me.
Which I personally do not share the same perspective,
yes.
or I don't share the same line of thinking. For example, when someone is translating in English, like John Temple, and he misses people collectively. So I personally do not, but I just wanted to find out from you if at all you came across that notion. Thank you very much.
Yes. There are lots of theories, some of them very wild indeed, which circulate about Kamuzu's origins. One of the most fundamental is who was his father? He suggested to me that perhaps he was in Goli rather than Chewa. I've even, as we discussed earlier, heard a theory that he might have been Tonga. But beyond these local questions, yes, there was a question of, is he Malawian at all? There was a theory, could he be from Ghana, because he just diverged there from that. I think it's all too easy to see why these theories might have emerged. When Banda returns to Malawi in 58, he is culturally so different to almost anyone in the country that to rural Malawians, I imagine he might have come from the moon. He didn't look like them, he didn't sound like them, he didn't eat like them, he didn't walk like them, he was completely different. And I suspect that's the origin of all of these theories, which become very, very fantastical. I've even heard this theory that he wasn't the real Kamuzu, he wasn't the little boy that we remembered from the village. And why is this? Because the real Kamuzu only had four toes. And the reason Kamuzu never took his shoes off and was obsessed with the wearing of shoes was because he never wanted to be embarrassed into a situation where he would have to reveal the actual number of toes that he had.
Yeah.
But again, you can sort of see why these explanations might have, been provoked by this strange man who is so obsessed with the wearing of shoes.
Yeah.
I think it's natural that there were these theories that circulated, to my mind, I think there could be almost no doubt that he was certainly Malawian, certainly mother was Chewa, father maybe Chewa would go to maybe Tonga, and as far as the language goes, I also think again that's probably the result of this sense of alienation from this man. Does he really speak Chichewa? The theory often goes that how could he speak Chichewa having been out of the country for so long? I don't find that personally plausible as a theory against it, because my own father left Thailand at age 7 and has never lived in the country since, but is still completely fluent in Thai. So I don't find it plausible that he must have lost his Chichewa. On the other hand, I imagine his Chichewa was, as he said, probably quite different to the Chichewa that was being spoken, hence the very bizarre response at University of Malawi, where he explains that, yes, the reason people wouldn't understand his Chichewa is when he left Malawi, he took with him pure Chichewa. And since then, what has emerged is this debased pigeon as the result of lazy Westerners not learning Chichewa properly, then passing their bad Chichewa onto their servants, and then the servants have taken that and passed it to the village. So he himself was in the unique position of being the sole custodian of pure Chichewa. Yes.
I like the way you presented your beginning statement about how you were impressed by how poverty engendered grace. And that's a very Western impression. For those of us who have had the privilege, or still have the privilege of living in both worlds, I don't know whether poverty has grace in itself. I live in a what you might call an academic institution, a community in the States, where within 5 miles or even less, we have one of the poorest part of the US. And I can choose to live in normal India without ever setting foot in San Bernardino. So I wouldn't know, I mean, even my own children do not know what it is to live in San Bernardino, which is just across the 10 freeway from our home. And so when you say you are impressed by how poverty engenders grace, I hear that from, and sometimes I actually say that myself, now that I've lived in America for so long. I don't know. I really don't know.
So, I would not say that poverty engenders grace.
Okay.
What I meant.
Yeah.
I chose words very carefully. What I meant was that poverty is endured with grace and with resilience. And I chose those words, grace and resilience, carefully because I did not want to make any claims about what is going on inside men's hearts.
Okay.
I don't want to say they're happy. I don't want to say they're contented. I don't want to say they're cheerful.
Okay.
I don't want to say anything like that.
Yeah.
But grace and resilience to me are external characteristics that are put on for an outsider. But despite being external characteristics, they're no less impressive for that.
Yeah.
It's an incredible achievement to act gracefully and resiliently in difficult conditions like that.
Yeah.
What's going on inside their hearts and lives, I make no claim whatsoever. But there is that difference. And I've worked in some pretty dry parts of the UK myself, and I don't see that same
is the difference. Yeah, if you walk into San Bernardino City.
Which city is
San Bernardino? I live in Loma Linda, which is so considered, some of you may have read about Loma Linda being in the green zone. So
right.
If you want to live to be 100, you come and live in Loma Linda.
Right.
That's not the reason why I'm living there. But I'm saying is, you're very right by saying that you don't seem to see the same kind of graciousness of just humanity. And like you, I've worked, honestly, been privileged to work pretty much throughout the world in some of the poorest parts of this world. And then you're right. It just doesn't seem to be in the West. There isn't that kind of resilience and endurance and sort of not just a giving up coping mechanism, but just being human.
Yeah.
even in the face of that kind of
yes.
deprivation.
Yes.
That, I'm glad you said that, because
yes.
that's what my impression is. Mm. Whether I'm at an Indian reservation in the or Native American reservation in the US, whether I'm in downtown, you know, Skid Row, or in San Bernardino
yes.
with my students, that's what I, I'm so glad that you mentioned
yeah.
that. Thank you.
Yeah, two more. Yes. So, thank you very much for a very stimulating discussion. So I had the good fortune of growing up in Malawi, and it just happened to coincide with pretty much with Dr. Banda's time in power. My father was in construction, and so I was delighted to hear the stories about the Museum Academy, because he was a site agent that built the Museum Academy. And I think I was about 13 years old, and I had to go and spend a penny. And I was told there was this tree that had great significance, so I kind of found my way there. I showed some respect, so I didn't do it there. And whilst I was doing my business, I thought to myself, why on earth would you build a school here? And at the time, of course, it was just the musings of a 13-year-old, basically having a pea in the bush. I subsequently realized, though, that, I mean, one of the things, whatever view of Hastings Banda was, he had a vision for Malawi. And that vision was centered on excellence in terms of whatever he wanted to do. So before that, you saw the emergence of the capital city here, which, if you look back at the time, was incredibly visionary. I mean, people don't recall that there was nothing, it was just bushland where the capital city is today. The Blues Academy has probably, you might say, the greatest flourish. But at the time, not only in Malawi, but also elsewhere in Africa, even though you may have had different points of view, perhaps different ideologies, this was quite a dominant, dominant thinking of many, what they call in Tanzania, the Uhuru leadership. So the first round of leadership of African liberation leaders. You know, they had and embraced that vision, whatever it may have been. So, yes, when you look back, it does seem that it was perhaps particularly wasteful. But at the time, it was what kind of the dominant thinking was. And certainly in Malawi, it's when you really saw, I would go on to say perhaps the greatest era of rapid progress,
yeah.
which we haven't really seen since.
Yeah.
But it wasn't just limited to to the grand projects. I'm now a development economist, so I travel around a lot. And for example, you can still see the legacy of agricultural productivity here in Malawi, which you don't see elsewhere, including in, for example, neighbouring Mozambique, which have a socialist ideology. But they didn't attach the same level of significance to embedding some deep-seated agricultural productivity, which he did here in Malawi, which you still see today.
And
if you've got any doubts, go to Mozambique and see for yourself, for example.
Yeah. Well, I think that's regardless of what you think about Umuzu, and regardless of whether or not you would agree here and now to the funding of, Umuzu Academy, where we should be presented with the proposal right now. The fact is, the project was done, the money has been spent, that's not going to be recovered. What are you left with that's positive? And I would say, you are left with a very, very powerful effort to sustain that tradition of excellence and academic ambition, which it's so, so easy to lose and very, very difficult to produce. And perhaps Kabuzo Academy was not the most efficient way of sustaining that, but it's not that easy sustaining a tradition like that. And for a little bit longer, it was sustained. And so try to take that as a positive from it.
So we've got 10 more minutes. Before we finish, maybe we have time for a question for this one, and then let's say hi there. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Lucas, go ahead.
I came late, so I missed the introduction. And I haven't read the book yet, which we sold out tonight. And I do hope, so I don't have questions, just comments. I hope that the book will be available.
Yeah.
We can read it, and it will come back, and we can just write again. But what I did catch, something that came in, was that you wrote this book for the white pages. Also said cultural appropriation is something that's touted by allowing those who are educated in the West. I guess that's me. So I want to see where I fit in and what my experiences might be after I read the book and then get to know a chance to engage as a child of Dr. Banda's regime, of parents and other relatives who face a different perspective and experience of Dr. Banda, as well as understanding the value that he gave to this country, I still have to leave space for those questions and engagement. I hope you're going to give us that opportunity. Because so many times, people like me want to authentically allow you to be out in the central region where you are getting your experiences from. But maybe more from where the laws comes from, which is where I'm from, and understanding what went into that from our history, even before him. Because yours begins with the missionaries and into this new age of post-colonial imperialism, which is a new kind of missionary called NGO, we donate similarities that I really want to have.
The peculiar feeling for me is that although I've said the book is for primarily for Western readers, it's the responses of the Malawians that I'm possibly most interested in.
Right.
And of course there is obviously, I suppose what I meant, the book is subtitled Lessons for the West. The lessons might be for the Westerners, I suppose, but the I've written inevitably a lot about Malawi in this book. I've tried to give a portrait of the country, and the most positive response of all actually has been from Malawian writers, especially John Luanda and Peter Kuntali, telling me they found my portrait plausible. And that was the most reassuring, because that was the most nerve-wracking thing for me, is when I write about this, will I actually get a feel for it? Have I perceived it correctly?
Before you come in, I was going to ask you to just read just a little bit, maybe a passage or two before we. Why don't he read? Let me take a question, then we close. We chat and
Do you want to try with a microphone? You don't think so?
Maybe
just
stand.
Stand.
Hopefully, I think we thought the mic probably made it worse. Okay. Can you hear it in the back?
Yeah.
I mean, so this is just a short passage. It's about my efforts to dig up something of the Catherine Tiwa myth, and also to try to explain why I thought that myth was important to the culture of village Malawi, but also to try and explain what that relationship between the myth and the rural life meant to me. And it's not too long, it's just maybe 3 or 4 minutes or so. According to another Chewa legend, the first man and woman made their home on a hilltop called Kaparitiwa. Their footsteps and the imprints of their tools were there stamped magically into the rock, connecting their descendants with the site forever. It was said that the marks could still be seen, so one fine spring day, Dr. Highbrow and I set off to find them. We knew the hill was somewhere within a forest reserve, not far from the capital, occasionally frequented by bird watchers, but otherwise mostly ignored by tourists. A little groundwork was needed to obtain a guide, but eventually we were introduced to an old man who agreed to take us to the place. and we ambled several hours through woodland thronging with birds and butterflies, crossed gentle brooks and waded through bracken, and then we came upon a kiln for smelting, a giant clay funnel, sunken, cracked, and sprouting with foliage and wildflowers. I'd seen similar elsewhere in Malawi, Iron Age relics that were active as late as the 1930s, and this was the only trace of human activity, as far as the eye could see. We hauled ourselves up a steep, rocky staircase, clutching at tufts of shrub to steady our ascent, and at the summit we gazed east through mist to Banda city, west over the dark forests of Mozambique. All around, the boundless sky glowed orange with cloud and iridescence after a spell of light rain. There followed some uncertainty as details from the myth were identified. Here, was man's first footstep on Earth. Our guide pointed to an oblong indentation in the ground. A second smaller one was explained as the first woman's. There was their original maize mortar, a small concave boulder. That forked crack in the rock was the imprint of their home. We traipsed on, a shallow pool was the winnowing basket they had used to separate maize from chaff for the first time. We were skeptical of these attributions, but enchanted by the strange atmosphere of the place with its preternatural stillness and dazzling haze. Our guide could not be persuaded to take us to an associated shrine, which was perhaps evidence that it was still active. But as we ventured to the edge of the peak, we noticed two small and shabby bowls of plastic filled with maize beer and millet seeds sodden with rain. They were votive offerings, mouldy but fairly recently left there. New men in Est, Dr. Highbrow exclaimed, some god is in this place. The Kapuratiwa myth implied a point of transition from nomadic to settled life in one place. The hallmarks of this were crop cultivation, house building, and burial, a triad that still captured perfectly the essence of the Malawian village with its cornfield, brick kiln, and coffin workshop. Even the most important tools of its daily life remained identical to those described in the legend. A boy received his first hoe in affirmation of his manhood, and is sometimes the only durable object he will ever possess. The mortar is the woman's symbol of abundance. I remember a gule dance in which husband and wife bush pigs cavorted together around the mortar. The wife bush pig then lay on the floor, keeping it clenched between her thighs, while the husband pranced above her, thrusting rhythmically into it with the enormous phallic pestle. Teeming crowds of children whooped delightedly at this suggestive display, and the maize burst green all around. Here was a people who owed everything to their tiny patches of the earth. Their claim to these was validated by the generations who had lived and died before them, toiled and been buried in the same soil. This was the life of the burned girl, of Sangala, Flemings, and Lifestyle Boyo, and I sense in all of them an instinctual rightfulness to their place in the world. I knew no such feeling growing up in a Western metropolis, remote from nature, a stranger among so many others. I was an anywhere person. I might relocate to any other large city and my life would be essentially the same. In rural Malawi, I could observe from a distance what it meant to belong somewhere. To discover my connection with people and places, I had, like Banda, to turn to stories from the past, to classics, history, literature. For me, it was poets like Dylan Thomas and T.S. Eliot that most explicitly answered this need, and I sensed that many Malawian writers pursued the same end, salvaging myths, explaining ancient reflexes, reinventing ancestral certitudes for our unguided present. The alternative was the life of mental nomadism spreading throughout the West, easy because unattached, but unsettled and unconsoled. Thank you.
My question was in regards to succession. As you know, as what I thought about this as I was speaking about Julius Caesar, what, in your opinion, constitutes a good succession? I also thought about this because the idea behind it.
About What constitutes a good succession in leadership, political leadership, or other?
That's a political question.
Yes, I mean, I'm not sure I have a good positive answer. I can certainly say not the succession that took place following the fall of Muti Banda. Tempted to say something rather naughty about the succession of Muti Academy, but I'm not going to do that. I think that's one of the saddest aspects of Banda's story, actually. He obviously had this ambition and this vision about how a new generation of leaders was going to be trained up. And yet when it came to it, he clinged on to the point that everything became moribund, ossified, geriatric, and I suspect that even many sympathizers would feel that that was perhaps his the saddest aspect of his story. But I am, though, here starting to drift into the political, so I'll probably leave my thoughts at that.
Yeah. So on that high note, we end our discussion tonight. Alex will be here, who would love to sign his book, actually. thanks for coming out. It means a lot. Thanks for supporting us in here. Because just to say as well, we are, first and foremost, we are in publishing house. We've got a new, this one is, it's come out now, so it's a bestseller. It's called Press Apart, and we've got this is an edition, improved, and added and something there. Also, if you buy my book, I'll sign it for you.
And I've just started reading it, and I've thoroughly, I got hold of a copy yesterday for the first time, and I've just started reading it, and I'm thoroughly, thoroughly enjoying it. So yeah, I would strongly recommend it, it's amazing what I've read so far. Excellent, thank you so much.